I had a heart attack. I died, and they got it started back up again.
These are the paddles.
Oh, my God!
Clear.
Clear.
Bye-bye. Hello, I'm Jeffrey. I'm here to talk about an event that occurred in my life on the 3rd of July, 2020, that basically changed my whole life in a matter of seconds. It was a Friday, started out normally, woke up, had my coffee, had my cigarette, ate my breakfast, got dressed to go do the yard work. I went outside, got to the shed, got the weed eater out, and did the trimming in the front yard. And basically trimmed all of the front of the house before I went to go get the lawnmower. Everything was fine. I didn't feel anything. It was normal warm, a little bit sweaty. Started to get hot as far as the sun beating down. So after I did the weed eating, I came into the house and I have one of those sweat cloths that you soak with water, put underneath your hat, and it helps to keep your head cool while you're outside in the sun. So I put that on and everything was fine. I went out to the shed. After putting the weed eater up, I was pushing the lawnmower out, which is a riding lawnmower. Put it into neutral, started pushing it, and at that point, I started to feel something weird in my chest. Didn't think anything of it. It was like, okay, not a problem. Pushed the lawnmower, jumped on it, started it up, started riding to the gate, drove to the gate, everything was fine. Put it in idle. Got off the lawnmower, opened up the gate, and seemed to have a little bit more of a pain in my chest. Nothing significant, just a little bit more pain. It wasn't shooting down my arm, wasn't going up my neck, didn't feel anything other than just a center pain right here, pushing in the center of my chest. And it was constant. So I got back on the lawnmower, rode through the gate. So I drove down the driveway, mowed up the side towards the driveway, on the driveway towards the house, got off of there. And then I started to make my first pass in the front yard of the house. And as I was driving the lawnmower, it started to increase the pain in my chest. Didn't signify anything as being weird or anything like that. It was just a constant increased pressure on my chest, like someone started pushing harder and harder on my sternum. Made my first pass all the way around the front of the house, and at that time, as I was coming up towards where the mailbox is, I realized I forgot to put gas in the lawnmower. So I was driving back down the center of the lawn of the driveway to get gas. Now, I had already pulled the gas out of the driveway earlier, so it was out of the garage. It was in the front of the garage door. So I stopped the lawnmower, lifted the hood, saw that I had maybe a half inch of gas left in the gas tank, went to get gas from the gas can, got the vent open on the gas can, pulled the tube out, walked over to the lawnmower, and as I was attempting to take the cap off the lawnmower, my hands didn't seem to be working properly. There was a lot of shaking in my hands. They weren't grasping properly like I normally do. You just turn and grasp and turn. They weren't grasping. It was hard for me to control them. After I got the gas cap off, I tried to lift the gas can up to fill the tank. And then it hit me that I couldn't lift the gas can. The pain in my chest started hurting more. And that's when I realized this isn't normal. So I struggled to put the gas cap back on the gas tank in the lawnmower, got that put on. I put the tube back in the gas can and closed that back up, lifted that up and took it to the garage door. And just going that short 8 to 10 feet walk wore me out, and the chest pain was extremely worse by that point. I punched in the code for the garage door, and it was a struggle internally for me to walk into the house to get to where I needed to tell Tracy to take me to the doctor. I got into the house, and as soon as I walked in the house where the AC was, I just started sweating profusely all over. I felt cold, clammy, and I was soaking wet. I wasn't sweating outside, but I started sweating once I got into the house because something was not right. And I then sat down in the recliner, and everything just seemed to lose all sense of feeling as far as being able to control anything. I couldn't lift my hands up. If you can see my arms, I could lift them up about this high, but I couldn't get them to do anything. And it was too much work to lift my arms 3 inches. So I would drop them back down, and then I just started feeling like I had to go to the bathroom. Not to urinate, but a bowel movement. And then I started getting nauseous, and I picked up the trash can we had next to the chair and held that and leaned over to the other side of the chair in case I was going to vomit. So I had that. So at the same time, there was no pain emanating anywhere from my chest. It was centered in my chest. It was right there. Didn't move. Didn't stop. All it did was increase. The pain just kept getting worse and worse and worse. It was an elephant sitting on my chest.
He's having that chest pain, feeling like an elephant is sitting on his chest.
Because I couldn't do anything, I was getting extremely irritable, mean, and nasty, as I felt like nothing was being done to help me, and I didn't know how to express myself.
Yes, very normal. He was. It's very normal. And again, it has to do with the oxygenation. He's getting to the point where he's having difficulty breathing. All he's trying to do is cope with what is going on. And that makes you irritable, agitated, anxious. That's just a very normal sign of somebody getting ready to, you know, go into cardiac arrest, somebody not doing well.
I reclined the back of the seat, kept the legs down, but reclined the back of the seat, leaned back, closed my eyes, and just waited for whatever to happen to happen.
So the day this happened, I had had a dental procedure, and the tooth that they worked on, which was a back upper tooth, was fine. But I don't know what happened, but they hit me in the face or something, because my whole jaw had a knot on it and it was bruised and it was awful. I was supposed to take it easy for a couple of days. So I had taken a pain pill and I was just kicked back on the couch. Jeffrey was doing the yard, and he came in and he leaned over in the kitchen, and he's done that before. He's leaned over and said, oh, it's really hot outside. But he leaned over and he was there for more than what he usually would be. And he didn't get a glass of water. And he walked in the living room and he just plopped down in the recliner. He's done that before too, where he'll say, oh, it's so hot outside, I'm gonna die. When I looked at him, he wasn't red like you would get from being outside. He was a gray color. And I have had a lot of experience with emergencies, life and death situations. I've seen people die. I've seen bodies after they've been dead for some time. I have never seen the color that Jeffrey was that day. It was just this weird gray color. He wasn't sweating like he was outside and it was hot, like it's, you know, dripping down your face. It was beads of sweat. I guess that's what the paramedic has called diaphoretic. But the sweating was as concerning to me as his color. And he just seemed to be kind of out of it. And he said, I need to go see the doctor. Well, he's told me before he needs to see the doctor, and it's a month later that he actually makes an appointment and goes to see the doctor. So he was just saying something was wrong. You know, I just thought really quickly, if I put him in the car and I take him to the hospital, that's going to take time, and I don't know that I can handle him. And besides that, I'm on pain medication from what's going on in my mouth. I thought, I'm going to call 911 and have the ambulance come. And if they get here and he's just overheated, then no harm, no foul, and I'm sorry I wasted their time. But I've just never seen that color before. So I picked up the phone, and when we've done the timeline of this, it was about a minute and a half from the time I saw him in the kitchen to when I was dialing the phone. As I was dialing 911, Jeffrey had he had been sitting back with his eyes closed, and he leaned up and he said, do something. And he was just, I've never heard him like that. And Jeffrey doesn't scream. He doesn't yell at me. So I just never heard even that tone in his voice. So I told him, just calm down. I'm calling 911. And I put it up to my ear to get the, you know, see that it connected. And then I put it down to put it on speakerphone. And I had him on speakerphone the whole time. But mind you, I'm a little loopy from the pain medication. That went away. I mean, I just went into, what do I need to do? And I thought, if this is a heart attack, if this is something that's threatening his life, how long do I have before he's going to go unresponsive until he falls out of the chair and onto the floor and I have to do CPR? So the first thing I did was make sure the door was open. And then I put the dog up so that she wouldn't be under everybody's feet. And by the way, if you've never seen a Barks Buddy, you need to get one of these things, because we have a miniature schnauzer and she goes nuts when people are in the house. But when you tap on that Barks Buddy, I mean, she stops. So that was very helpful as well. Then I just sat with him and I was talking with the 911 operator and answering the questions that he had. When the 911 operator asked Jeffrey if he was allergic to aspirin, Jeffrey lost his mind. So I was trying to keep Jeffrey calm. I was trying to stay calm. I was just amazed that the ambulance got here, and it was 6 minutes and 15 seconds. It was incredible. So there was no way I could have gotten him in the car and to the hospital, even Madison Hospital, which is only 3 minutes away, getting someone's attention. He would not have gotten the care that he needed. And thank God for Deanna and the firefighters that were there that day. Thank you for everything that you've done, everything that you did, because you truly saved his life, and you saved mine in the process.
What's the address of the emergency? Okay, tell me exactly what happened.
My husband was doing the yard, and he's come in, and he said he's got chest pains, and he's really weak and numb. He's sitting right here.
What's the phone number you're calling from in case we get disconnected?
Six.
Stay on the line. I'm going to let you speak directly to the ambulance service.
Calm down, baby. Take deep breaths. Well, you're not going anywhere right now.
Ambulance service, help is on the way. What's the location of your emergency?
It's a home address.
Thank you so much. Tell me exactly what happened.
My husband was out doing the yard, and he came in and he said he's got chest pains, and he's really numb and weak. He had a heart attack when he was 38. He's 55 now.
Okay. But are you with him now, ma'am?
I am. He's in the chair.
Okay. And how old is he?
55.
Okay, I've already got help on the way. Is he awake?
Yes, I'm awake.
Yes, he's right here.
All right. And let's see. Okay. Is he completely alert?
He's just very, but he's talking.
Okay.
He's very agitated.
He's very what?
He's very agitated.
Okay, I understand that. Is he breathing normally?
Shallowly.
Very shallow.
Okay. Does he have difficulty speaking between breaths?
No.
Okay, good. Is he changing color?
He's just gray.
Okay. Is he clammy or having cold sweats?
Yeah.
But he's completely sweaty because he was outside mowing.
Right, right.
I feel like I'm getting nauseous.
He said he feels nauseous.
Okay. Did he take any drugs or medications in the past 12 hours?
Maybe aspirin.
Okay.
I need a nurse at the pediatric, please.
Okay. So did you take any other medicine, sir?
No.
Okay.
Okay, so he's had baby aspirin. How many? Just one?
Yeah, he takes one every day.
Okay. All right. Has he been involved or in contact with anybody that has flu-like illness?
No.
Great. Okay. Tell me if he has any of the following symptoms: a measured body temperature of greater than 100.4 degrees, or a fever that is hot to touch at room temperature.
Well, he's been doing the yard. I don't know. I mean,
okay.
He's all flu-y.
All right. Any chills?
No, just nausea.
Okay. Any difficulty breathing or shortness of breath?
Temperature's 96.4.
Great, great. Any difficulty breathing or shortness of breath?
Shortness.
Shortness of breath, he said.
A persistent cough?
No.
No.
Any other new respiratory problems such as persistent sneezing, wheezing, or congestion?
No.
No.
Great, great. Okay. Like I say, help has been on the way ever since we started talking. And I would like to know if you guys have any, does anyone there have any aspirin or medication containing aspirin available?
We've got the baby aspirin.
Okay. All right. Please stay on the line. I need to check three more things. If someone else is there with you, send them to get the aspirin. If you're by yourself, don't get the aspirin yet. Okay?
Well, it's me and them.
Okay. Is he allergic to aspirin?
No, I've been taking it.
No, he's
always 38.
Right. Right.
He's very agitated.
Yes,
I'm sorry.
I understand that, but I'm required to ask these questions.
Sure. Okay, let me, if it's in the other room, I'm going to grab that.
Aspirin? Okay.
Yeah, the baby aspirin.
Okay, has he vomited blood or coffee ground material in the last 24 hours?
Oh, no.
Has he passed black or bloody stools in the past 24 hours?
Mm-hmm. No.
Okay, great. All right, so you got the low-dose aspirins. I want you to tell him to chew four of the low-dose baby aspirins right now.
Okay, I just gave them
to him.
And it's important that he chews them, okay?
You heard him chew them? Come on, hi. Okay, the medic just got here.
Are they with him?
Yes, they're here now. Thank you so much.
All right. Thank you, ma'am. I hope he does okay. Bye-bye.
Thank you so much. Bye.
I didn't feel any relief, even with the aspirin. The guy kept asking you the same question over and over, and I kept getting irritated. So I yelled at him what was going on. I told him I was having a heart attack and that I needed to, for lack of a better term, to quote myself, I need to take a...
He was profusely sweating, diaphoretic. He was, you know, just trying to hold on to the side of the chair. You could tell that he was feeling very anxious. That was the first question I asked him. How long had he been outside? He told me 45 minutes. You're not going to look like that in 45 minutes. He was extremely pale, which means the blood was gathering in the core part of the body, trying to keep his heart going. He didn't look good. As we say, he did not look good, and we needed to go. But I had to get my first strip to verify what was happening. once I had the EKG strip, I knew exactly what was going on, and that verified that we needed to go now.
When the EMTs arrived and they came into the house, at that point I felt a little sense of relief because they were there to do some help, some work to help me get over this pain, to help stop this from happening. I'm assuming they did some type of quick assessment of me. I remember them sticking something on my finger to check my oxygen levels. I remember them trying to take my blood pressure. I was actually leaning back further in the recliner with the legs not down, but the back still reclined, and them attempting to attach leads to my chest to see what was going on. I remember them taking my temperature. It was funny because they kept lifting my shirt up, and the leads they put on would fall off because I was so sweaty, and then the shirt would fall back down so they couldn't see what was going on. So I told them just to cut my shirt open so they could actually get to whatever they needed. They asked Tracy to get a towel so they could dry off my chest in order to get the leads to stick to my chest. During this whole process, they kept asking how I'm feeling. I kept saying it hurts, my chest hurts, my chest hurts. I tried to make light of the moment during everything that they were doing. So after they cut my shirt, they started to shave my chest. I asked them to shave it in the shape of a heart. They sort of laughed at that. They kept doing what they were doing. I finally got the leads on, and I guess they finally had their EKG readouts coming out to let them know what was going on. They started working on me, and they seemed to get more and more intense as they were realizing what all was going on. At this whole time, I still have my eyes closed, laid back. Chest pain is still there. By this time, I had sweated so much, and I kept asking for a glass of water. They said no. I asked for something to drink. They said no. I said, I have cotton mouth. My body was sweating so profusely, there was literally no moisture in my mouth at all. And at that point, they tried to give me nitroglycerin, and they stick that under your tongue to make it dissolve. Well, there's no dissolving nitroglycerin when you have no saliva in your mouth.
Gave him the one nitro in the house, got him on the stretcher, getting him out to the truck. You had already given him the aspirin. So our route goes aspirin, nitro. We get an IV started on oxygen. This wasn't anything that was fake. This wasn't, it was right there, plain black and white. We needed to go. We got him on the stretcher and out to the truck. The first thing I do once out in the truck is I send them a copy of my EKG transmitted from my unit over to the hospital so that they already have it, they already know what's going on, and they're getting prepared on their end to be able to treat him.
I do not remember being placed on the gurney. I don't remember how I got on the gurney. I remember leaving the living room on the gurney.
Yep, I heard it. Steph.
Woohoo! Don't you love my yard?
Yep. All right, now you could come down, but they're going to make you stand outside in the ER in the garage.
Yeah.
So if you want to do that, that's fine. They'll let you know if you can go back or you can't go back, okay?
Okay.
But Huntsville Main in the parking garage where the ER is where they're having the entrance.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Deanna, the paramedic that was on scene, was incredible, and she was very confident, very professional, and very clear when she spoke with me, which is exactly what I needed that day. She wasn't condescending in any way. She was just pointed and focused on what she needed to tell me. She needed me to hear that, and this woman is a professional. I mean, she is amazing, and for her to have that insight of how to deal with someone like me who is watching this happen to Jeffrey. Thank you. Thank you, Deanna.
the fire department had pulled the back loader out, but it hadn't gotten it to the stop point. The divider just kept sliding on into the ambulance. We brought the stretcher back out of the ambulance, pulled the piece of gear out again, made sure it was locked this time, and we were able to load the stretcher onto it. The back loaders are outstanding. I used to have to lift people from the ground level and then put them into the ambulance on the stretcher. And through all these years, things have changed quite a bit. He wasn't stable. Once in the back of the ambulance, we needed an IV. Reason for an IV is I had to make sure we had access to push medications if he was to lose his heartbeat. If he was to go unresponsive for me, if, you know, he was to go into cardiac arrest.
They were trying to insert an 18-gauge needle in this arm right here. At the same time, they were still checking to see if the nitroglycerin had dissolved, and I told them no. I said, there is no way this nitro is going to dissolve because I have no moisture in my mouth. I have cotton mouth. Nothing's going to dissolve. They said the only thing they could give me was saline solution. So they squirted a little bit underneath my tongue.
He was still awake. He was still talking to me. His heart was still beating, and we needed to get to the hospital before that stopped. He had a little less than 50-50 chance. So if I had gotten there and you hadn't given him any, that's the first thing I would have done. But that aspirin is our first step. Aspirin thins the blood. So by thinning the blood, they were trying to get it to pass through that clot or clottage to get it going through to bring that oxygen to the heart. After that step was the nitroglycerin. That vasodilates the blood vessels. Again, trying to open that area up just a little bit more so that blood can pass through into his heart, keep his heart beating. And then the last one we gave was morphine, and the morphine actually relaxes the heart muscle so that it's not having to work quite as hard, again, trying to keep that blood flow to the heart and trying to keep that oxygenated blood flow to the heart, because that's how the heart lives. Without those things, the heart stops working. And that was the important part that day, was to keep that heart moving.
Hey. Did you hear it?
They said they think he's having a heart attack. He's so hot. And,
yeah.
You know, he's just starting to do the yard.
Yeah.
And he was just covered in sweat, and he walked in and he said, something's wrong. And so they're taking, not letting any visitors down there.
Right.
And he said, I can go down and stay in the parking lot. Just to, so I'll go down and stay in the parking lot. But I'm just like,
I mean,
I'm having a heart attack now.
I hear you.
I'm so scared.
I'll take care of the heart. He asked me to.
Oh.
So,
thank you.
Sir. Sir.
Sir.
It was a second dose of nitroglycerin. It was still asking him what's going on, how's the pain. That was putting him on oxygen. That was wiping his chest off and reconnecting some of those leads because he was so diaphoretic. And I got a second EKG strip started, which hadn't changed at all. Then it was time to go. For me, if I'm running lights and sirens, I do this 20 years, if I turn on the lights and sirens, we desperately need to get to the hospital. This is an absolute must, because I can do everything I can in the back of that ambulance, but I can't do for him what he needs. He needed to go to the cath lab. That was the goal point right there, get him to the hospital. It's the family who rules where we go. I knew what he needed. He needed the cath lab, and Madison Hospital does not have a cath lab at this point in time. Remain calm. That is the hardest thing for somebody to be watching their loved one having so many problems and getting irritable and agitated as it's going on, for the family member to remain calm. If you're going hysterical while I'm trying to take care of your loved one, you're not helping me any whatsoever, because now I pretty much have two patients. I have to try and get you to calm down and understand what's going on and be taking care of this person over here and doing procedures. You getting together the medications, their driver's license, an ID of any sort, a list of what kind of medical problems they have, allergies, that type of thing helps me tremendously in the back of an ambulance, because that person might not be able to talk to me. The biggest thing is, and I've seen it a lot, and what helps us tremendously is a family member will go ahead and type us out a sheet. This sheet tells me all the medications the person takes, tells me if there's allergies, tells me if they're allergic to medications, tells me what they have going on health-wise, whether it's heart, respiratory, you know, seizures, all of that's listed there. So when I get in the back of the ambulance, after hearing everybody tell me that, get it back there, forget everything I just heard because I'm doing 101 things, that piece of paper helps me know what's going on. When I get to the hospital, I then hand that sheet of paper to them. Because when I see that, I don't say, do you have history of seizures? Do you have heart problems? Because it's all right there. You did well. You did well. You kept pretty much calm. You stepped back. You weren't under our feet yelling at us, what are you doing? What are you doing? How are you doing it? Why are you doing this? What was that you gave him? We didn't have that. You sat back and you were calm. Once we got him on the stretcher and the guys were taking him out the door to the truck, that's when I talked to you. I remember getting a card from you that day with the phone number on it. And I told you that I would give this to the nurse as soon as we got there so that they can contact you and let you know what's going on. He was talking, he was complaining, he was arguing with me. So, you know, that makes me happy, because if he's doing that, I know he's still with me. I know he knows what's going on.
I told him, I said, I need a mask, not a nasal hose. I think I was saying it, maybe I was garbled, I don't know.
Between myself and the firefighter that was in the back of the truck, we must have asked him 100 million questions of the same questions over and over and over again, which caused him to be irritated. I want to get information. I need to know how much pain he's having, if it has changed. If it has changed, how much has it changed? What is working for you? You know, is that helping? Did it not help? And it also allows me, if I have another paramedic riding in the back with me, to bounce off of him that, yes, I did this. What did you do? We did this. This is how this is going. And it allows us to work together, knowing what each other has done.
It was after the third nitro tablet was put in. Each time they gave me a nitro, they would ask me if it was dissolved. They need to give me some more saline solution. Once they would dissolve, I would give them a thumbs up, say nitro's dissolved, and they'd say good. They'd check their watch, and I could hear the radio actions going on, contacting the hospital, giving them updates.
The nurse at Maine. When you're passing, go ahead. Hey, Allison Deanna on 211. I'm coming to you with a possible STEMI. I have a patient here. He is approximately 55 years old. We have gone ahead with 4 baby aspirin, 3 nitro. I've given 4 of morphine so far. He is on flush O2. We are showing elevation in V1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1 and 2 on regular leads and AVL. He has had 2 prior MIs to this. We have a blood pressure 108 over 68, pulse is 69, respiratory rate 18, O2 sats 95% on room air, severely diaphoretic. He's also had Zofran. We should be at your facility in about 15. Do you have any questions?
Negative. Bravo 11 on arrival.
10-4, Bravo 11 on arrival.
Trying to add some levity again to it. Whenever we hit the railroad tracks or bumps, I would go, woohoo, yeehaw! Like it was a fun ride, and they were out thinking I was freaking out because of pain, and they would ask me, are you in pain? I said, no, it's a fun ride. Each time they asked me what the p- pain level was in my chest. When we got in the ambulance, it was an 8. By the time we got to the hospital with the single dose of morphine given to me in 4-shot increments in the IV, the 3 nitro tablets they gave me, it had decreased to a 6.
When we run lights and sirens, it isn't going to necessarily be fast. It is to tell the public and the cars, let's move to the side, let's let them through. They need to get there as soon as they can.
They were honking the horn just to let traffic know they were coming down. They had the sirens on. They were having more issues trying to get people out of the way. And I could hear them honking the horn. I'm assuming as we got close to intersections, whether the lights were green or what, I don't know. It was just an interesting drive.
Right here.
I remember entering the ER. The doctors and techs and nurses were asking me again the same questions that I had answered in the ambulance, that my wife had answered on the 911 call. I don't know if it was to evaluate whether I was still aware of my surroundings, if I knew what was going on. When they cut my shirt at the house, they cut up straight up the center, so it would just open up to allow them to place the leads on for the EKG. They had the IV in this arm. They were trying to attempt another IV over here on this arm with a smaller gauge. I told them to just go ahead and cut off the shirt, and they did. And I said, you cut off my favorite shirt. And again, trying to add humor to it. And they said, is this your favorite shirt? And I said, no, I'm just joking. Just get rid of it. Don't worry about it. And they did that. Nurses putting leads, taking leads off, putting leads on, drying my body off because I was still sweating. And then they started to shave even more of my chest. And I think that's where I got cut, was in the ER when they were shaving the right side here. They took off a layer of skin. So I had blood coming from my chest there. Then they had my shorts pulled down and I asked them why they were doing that. And they said, well, we're going to go in through your arm for your cardiac cath, but if we have to, this is a backup plan. So they had to shave here to prep my groin area for them to go in through my leg if they couldn't go in through my arm.
When we came into the hospital, we went directly back to his room. When we got to that room, they already had the crash cart sitting out in case he went into cardiac arrest. It was a tiny room. I can't tell you how many people were in that room. Everybody asking 100 million questions. Another IV being started for blood work. Pads being put on his chest in case they needed to shock him. They called a heart alert immediately overhead that brought in the cardiologists, that brought in the cardiac nurse practitioners. They had him wheeling out of the room before I could get my signature from the nurse saying that I had brought him to the room. So he was that quick headed up.
Now, at this point, when they pulled my shorts down and started shaving there, I think that's to me when I blacked out. I can still have my eyes closed. I remember the darkness and I remember the sounds around me, but I don't remember anyone specific or anything specific being said. I just remember it was like a dream. And then all of a sudden, I felt the doctor slap my face, or what I thought was slapping my face, and I came to, and they called my name, and I said, yes, I'm here. And they asked me if I remember my name, and I said, yes, I did, and I told them my name again. And then I think I went out again.
Because like he said, once he got up to the cath lab, and he didn't realize what was going on anymore. When he blacked out, that's when they shocked his heart. That means his heart stopped. There's only 2 rhythms you can shock. That would be your ventricular tachycardia or your ventricular fibrillation. First one, tachycardia, just means you got pulses that are very fast going on, but it's not communicating with the heart. And ventricular fibrillation is where the heart's just kind of sitting there, just kind of punching about back and forth just a little bit, but it's not allowing the heart to do anything. The shocking part on both of those, when we shock, we're stopping the heart for a second so that we can try and get a normal rhythm back. heart stopped on its own. So it depends.
So there's still electrical current in it.
Mm-hmm.
If you get to it fast enough, you can shock it back.
Can shock it back.
That's what happened.
Mm-hmm. That's what happened to him. Mm-hmm. And whether they did that on the cath table or they did it on the way to the cath lab to do it, what happened was his heart went into one of those two rhythms, VTAC or VFib, as we call it. And by shocking it, they were able to get it to reverse and get the heart beating again.
And then I woke up in the ICU. According to the doctor, my heart stopped. I was dead. My heart had stopped beating for a moment. What I thought of as the doctor slapping my face like a baby being born, it wasn't that. It was them actually shocking me to restart my heart. And apparently they did that and it restarted right up. So he didn't slap me, he jolted me. He inserted a cardiac cath, opened up my artery, which is over the center part of my heart, the front artery to my heart, feeds right into what they call the chamber of the heart where the apex is. The doctor said it was 99% closed and they had to open it up, and they opened it up with a stent and a balloon. So now it's working. That's the event that changed my life. But that got me all the way up to the ICU. So while we were in the ICU, my wife Tracy was allowed to see me at the same time we're still having the COVID-19.
So after Jeffrey left in the ambulance, I talked with our neighbor BJ, and I was just dazed. I just could not believe what was happening. And so I flew in the house and I put my shoes on, I grabbed my purse, and I was out the door. Halfway down the block, I realized none of the doors to the house were even locked. So I turned around and I came back and I locked the front door and the back door and got everything situated. And I was driving down to the hospital, which is about 20 to 25 minutes. That was a tough drive because Jeffrey is my high school sweetheart. He's my first love. And after high school, we went our separate ways. And 27 years later, we reconnected on Facebook, and we were married just over 6 months after that. Last year, we celebrated our 10-year anniversary with renewing our vows at the beach. He was my first love, and he's my life love. And as I was driving down to the hospital, I just had a flood of emotion. But then those feelings gave way to overwhelming grief. And I lost my father, my mother, my grandmother, all within 3 years. And I even had my dog die. I would not have made it through that time without Jeffrey. And as I'm thinking of all this, I'm thinking, what if he loses his heartbeat? What if he stops breathing? And I cut two people off, which I would like to apologize for. Whoever you are, thank you for paying attention and not hitting me that day. You know, I've dealt with so many emergency situations, but when it's your loved one that's having the issue, it is completely different. So as this grief was coming up, and I was thinking, please God, don't let him be brain dead and don't let him be dead. I just thought, I need to pull over. So I was about halfway to the hospital and I pulled into a parking lot, and I called my very dear friend, Kathy. And I felt like, you know, I'd kind of been doing what I needed to do, and I was getting through this and everything was fine. And as soon as I heard her voice on the phone, I couldn't even speak. All she said was, what's wrong? When I could speak, I said, Jeffrey had a heart attack and he's on his way to the hospital right now. She was just amazing. She said, he's going to be fine. You need to be strong for him. You just do what you need to do and you take care of him. So she was on it. And for me, I hung up the phone with her and I prayed and I just fell apart. I just wept and I cried and I pleaded and I begged, God, don't take his life. Just keep him here. It scared me. It scared me so bad that I might lose him. So I got through all that and I got to the hospital, and I just want to say Huntsville Hospital has an amazing staff. From the people in the parking garage that were pointing me to the right place to go because of all the COVID, to the security guards, to the registration desk. It was so funny when I walked in, of course, you had to fill out a form and they take your temperature and all these kind of things, and you have to have a mask on, which was great because it was covering the big knot that I had on my face. But I thought they needed insurance information, so the first place I went was to the registration desk. As I was talking to the guy that was behind the desk, it was taking forever, but the phone rang and it said Huntsville Hospital. So of course my heart just stopped and I thought, oh my God, what's going on? And so I ripped that mask off and I answered the phone. And it was Dr. Krasnow, and I hope I'm pronouncing that right, but he said, this is Dr. Krasnow, and I wanted you to know that we just put a stent in for Jeffrey. He's doing great. His heart did stop, and we got it right back, but he's doing great. He's going to be up on the cath floor, so you can see him then. And, oh, I got to go. We got another one. And it's just another day at the office for him. Not a big deal. I was excited. I was thankful. I was shocked that it was so fast that they got him in and taken care of. And it was amazing. So I was gently nudging this young man at the desk. Could you please hurry? They said, I can go up and see Jeffrey, my husband, who just had a heart attack. And he said, oh yeah, I'll get to this. I'm going just as fast as I can. Well, that wasn't fast enough. So I said, whatever you need, you have a copy of the card, you've got my phone number, just call me, but I'm going now. And so I went upstairs and could not find him. There was a nurse on one of the floors that actually pretty much took me by hand to find the area that he was in. And when I saw him, you know, Jeffrey is very laid back. And of course he had morphine too, and who knows what else they had given him. So he was in a pretty good state of mind. I just wanted to hold on to him. I just wanted to hug him, and I kept telling him how much I loved him. And he's like, well, I love you too, and you know, no big deal. But it was a huge deal for me. Jeffrey and I tell each other that we love each other every day, and I'm so grateful for that. No matter what happened that day, Jeffrey knows I love him. He knows that he's my life. I'm just very, very grateful that God blessed him with life. Everything went right that day, from me being able to call the ambulance so quickly, to the ambulance responding, to everyone at the hospital being ready for him and them putting in the stent. It is amazing how everything worked. And it worked right, except for the two people that I cut off, and I am sorry. That's something else, is if someone does something as stupid on the road, maybe give them some slack, because I didn't mean to cut those people off, but I'm very grateful they were paying attention. So I got to see him there, and he was kind of in a cubby room at that time. They said they didn't have any beds available, so they're waiting for a bed. So I stayed with him until they got him into a room, and they were getting him settled. Then the nurse told me that they only were allowing visitors for 1 hour for the whole day. And I just kind of panicked. I mean, I've spent the night at the hospital many times curled up in a chair in the corner, and that's just not allowed because of the COVID situation. The nurse did say, if you want to bring back a cell phone or an iPad for him, then you can, you know, Skype or do Zoom calls and you can see each other tonight. So of course, I didn't have a cell phone. I didn't even think to bring it with me. I told her it's about 20, 25 minutes to get home, so it's going to be about an hour before I can get back. And she said, well, that's fine. I hope that's not breaking the rules. But whatever it was, she let me bring him back the iPad and his cell phone so that at least we could talk to each other and I could see him. And he had such a hard night that night. I wish I'd been there just to put a cold rag on the back of his neck. He just had a really, really hard time.
I was in ICU when I literally became aware of my surroundings again. I felt fine. My heart felt better. I didn't have the pressure that was there before. I wasn't in pain. I was hungry. I remember talking with the nurses. Because I was feeling better, I wanted to get out of the hospital. I don't like people doing things for me. I like doing for myself. I love taking care of people, helping people. But I was always taught, and I always remembered myself, that I should always be able to do for myself. I should always be able to take care of myself. And the feeling of not being able to take care of myself is very aggravating. At times, I inappropriately snap at those people that are around me to help take care of me. And I know I don't mean to do that. It's just an internal feeling of failure, not being able to take care of myself, not being able to do for myself, and having to rely on other people. And it's hard for me to allow people to do that, to allow people to step in and do what I can't do. The last cigarette I had was around 8 o'clock, Friday morning, the 3rd of July, 2020. I had my cigarettes in my side pocket of the shorts I was wearing. And normally while I'm working in the yard, as I switch between tools and take a break to get a bottle of water to drink, I will have a smoke. Well, I didn't stop for water yet, so I didn't stop for a smoke. So my last smoke was before I started doing all my yard work. I was being rolled down to the cardiac lab to have my cardiac cath. The doctor said, "You quit smoking, right?" And I said, "Yes, I did." And I reached into my pants pocket, pulled out my smokes and the carton or the pack of cigarettes I had, and I said, "Here you go." So they took my cigarettes from me, and that was it. After I left the ICU, I went to the PCU, and at that point, my wife was no longer able to visit me.
They told me on Saturday I could not come and visit, that he was not critical at that point, which was great. It's a good sign that they wouldn't let me come visit him, but still, it was very hard to have him up there.
After she left on Friday, she wasn't allowed back in the hospital, so she didn't get to see me Saturday or Sunday until I was discharged. The doctor came in on Sunday morning around 9 o'clock. I need to have clothes. And they said, "Okay, is your wife going to pick you up?" I said, "Yes, and I can have her bring my clothes." She said, "Well, we can get you disposable scrubs, and you can take those and go home in those, and you won't have to worry about your wife bringing up clothes and having them go through security and everything." I said, "Okay." So when I talked with my wife and told her about me being discharged and told her she didn't need to bring any clothes because they're going to take care of that here, she said, "Okay." That was around 12. Around 2 o'clock, they still hadn't worked out the pharmacy because they couldn't even find them. They didn't know where they were. So the nurse got involved, and the nurse and my wife figured out what was going on with that. They couldn't get the disposable scrubs. So I told the nurse, "Well, I could just wear two gowns, one way and one the other way, and I'll be covered up, and we'll be good to go." She said, "Okay, we'll need to get a wheelchair for you." I said, "Okay." That was at 2 o'clock. 3 o'clock, they couldn't find the wheelchair. And I got out of the hospital on my own two feet, accompanied by my RN nurse.
And when I saw him walking down the hallway in two hospital gowns, one forward and one backwards, and his socks with the non-skid bottoms, that's how he walked down the hospital with his mask on. It was crazy.
The nursing staff at the hospital was amazing. They tolerated me. I know there were a couple of times when I was trying to get out of bed and all I was showing was just my bottom because my hospital gown was open up in the back because I couldn't tie it. And I wanted to go to the bathroom, so I was trying to get out of bed. But I appreciate them. They are an excellent staff at the Huntsville Hospital. I am quite impressed with their professionalism, their friendliness, your ability to take care of patients, specifically someone like me who thinks and knows everything, the non-compliant patient, but I did try to do my best. Friday night was a tough night. They stood by me for 4 or 5 hours when an issue arose, and they helped me through that.
There's a video called Angels of Mercy, Paramedic Deanna. It's about her and about that day and what she did, but she did ease my mind because she told me about a piece of gear that they have called a Lucas.
And the first thing I asked for from the firefighter who was staying behind is to give me his Lucas, piece of gear that we use when somebody goes into cardiac arrest. It does CPR for me, basically. It's a unit that gets placed on the chest that looks like a plunger, and it's set to a piece of gear that starts beating that heart 30 times a minute. Once I change over to an oral airway, I get a tube into him so he can breathe. Then I can switch that to automatic, and it just beats his chest, literally beats his chest all the way to the hospital.
She said, don't worry about him not getting oxygen to his brain, because if he stopped breathing, they would use that apparatus and it would do CPR for them and give him oxygenated blood that he would need. So she said that was one thing I didn't need to worry about.
Tracy's asked me several times during our conversations of this event if I have been afraid. And the answer to that is no. I never once felt fear. I never felt afraid of what was going on. It was my perception, this is fixable, fix it, let's go on. The thought of dying never entered my mind. I wasn't afraid of dying because I didn't think I was dying. I didn't at this point believe that I was going to have my heart stop. Never entered my mind.
Told me in the truck a couple of times that he felt like he was dying. And he was. His heart was.
I had peace with God when I found Jesus Christ back in 2009. I do not remember praying because I wasn't afraid of meeting him. I wasn't afraid of seeing him. But I wasn't thinking of dying. I didn't think that I was going to die. If anything does happen to me, I feel bad that I've let Tracy down, because that means I'm not here to help take care of her. I'm not here to take care of my kids. They're adults now, but I still feel like I should be here to take care of them. But I've never been afraid of what was occurring. And I don't know if that's for everybody, if they're afraid when this happens to them. I just know for me, it wasn't fear. It was anger over lack of control of what was occurring, frustration over lack of control. And while I'm trying to communicate during this process of while these things were occurring, it may have sounded like I was irritated. And there's an irritation in my voice. It was because I was irritated because, again, I wasn't able to get things done, to take care of things, to put everything back the way it was supposed to be. Those were my feelings. How I was trying to handle things. How I was trying to take care of things that needed to be taken care of when I couldn't do it. I died. I'm alive. I'm going to do everything I can to stay alive. But I don't fear that death will come. I just want to put it off for as long as possible now. I had a heart attack when I was 38 years old. The one thing that saved my life at that point is, instead of baby aspirin, I ate full-size Bayer aspirin. I ate six of those at one time, chewed them up, and everything was fine. I had no aftercare after that. I knew I had the heart attack, and I had to keep taking baby aspirin, which I've been doing since then. But when I went to the doctors after that episode, they did all the physical testing that I was supposed to be doing, and they kept saying that my arteries were clear. I had no blockages. It was completely unexpected. Up until this occurring, every time I had a physical, they said my arteries were clear. I don't know how that changed in that short amount of time, in 3 years. No blockage to 99% blockage in one artery. It's a life-changing event.
My name is Donathan Hutchings, and Jeffrey's my best friend. I consider Jeffrey my brother, and last year I lost my baby brother due to depression. So on the Saturday night, or Saturday afternoon, when I got the call about Jeffrey's heart attack, it hit me on a level that I didn't think was really possible. Jeffrey's been one of those friends who's always been there. No matter what I needed, when I needed, all I had to do is pick up the phone. And to hear that his life was threatened like that sent a shockwave through me. He had already had a heart attack in the past. And then when I received the phone call from Tracy that he had had another one and that he was in the hospital, it was one of those situations where everything just runs through your mind, especially the worst case scenarios. At first I was in shock. I told my wife Kelly right there. She had the same reaction I did. We both love Jeffrey and Tracy dearly, and to have someone you care so much about having a possibility of dying and you don't know what's going on other than the fact you know that he's had a heart attack. Like I said earlier, just all kinds of things run through your mind. It still hasn't fully processed with me, even though now he's back at work. And yes, he does have to rest more and that kind of thing, simply because of the procedure he went under. There's always this constant thing in your mind that, am I going to see him tomorrow? Am I going to see him or talk to him tonight? So it's this thing that's constantly lingering. I still haven't fully grieved for my brother yet. And to have a shock like this, it just is very overwhelming. For me, the only thing I can do is just put everything in God's hands and pray for Jeffrey and Tracy and pray that he continue to be with us. I've never had this happen before. Like I said, Jeffrey's my brother, and even though I did lose an actual sibling, the thought of losing Jeffrey really for me is just unbearable. You just never know. You never know. Always keep in mind that when you talk to someone, you're with them, you know, you love them dearly, they're your friends, your family. Just keep in the back of your mind that that may be the last time that you see them or that you talk to them. And it's always important to let them know, you know, that they're loved and that they're cared for and that you may not get it next time.
Hey Jeffrey, in case you couldn't tell because I have no makeup on, I'm hot, sweaty, and my hair is a hot mess. This is Kelly. And I have been doing today what you were doing the day that you had your heart attack. And I just wanted to let you know that when we heard about it, we went into panic mode and afraid of loss mode, because you are a dear, dear friend. You and Tracy mean the world to us. We may not spend a whole lot of time together. We're busy people, but we love you. The day that you had your heart attack, you were overdoing it, but our minds tell us we're still young enough to do that. But our bodies are starting to tell us, all of us, that we're getting older and we need to take better care of ourselves. And I'm feeling a little hot and tired myself right now. And so I'm going to just end this by saying I love you. I love Tracy. I love our friendship. And I'm glad you're okay. I know you're still healing. And sorry. But just remember, we're not the young kids that we were, even though, like I said, our minds tell us we are. Our bodies are saying it's time to slow down. It's time to take it easy. So please do that. Please take it easy. You have time to do what you want to do as long as you're taking care of yourself. We'll take care of one another. And, well, just I love you.
My name is Kathy, and I've been friends with Tracy and Jeffrey since before they became Tracy and Jeffrey. And so when Tracy called me, and I was 365 miles away, to tell me that Jeffrey was on his way to the hospital with a heart attack, what I remember is that everything suddenly stopped. Tons of thoughts were going through my head. Oh my goodness, I hope that this goes well. Got to pray, start praying for Jeffrey right away. My second thought was, how am I gonna comfort my friend from 365 miles away? So all I could think of was to assure her that he was gonna be okay, because he had to be okay. A lot of times when people have a heart attack, it's not okay. And your whole world changes because we take our friends for granted sometimes. We always think that when we tell them goodbye that we're gonna see them again. Sometimes that's not the case. So it's so important to appreciate your friends every day and to honor them. I was extremely worried about Jeffrey because he's the most unlikely person that I would think that would have a heart attack, because he seems fit and he's always busy and doing things, and just wouldn't think of him as being unhealthy. I was shocked, totally shocked. And I just couldn't imagine what was gonna happen with things being the way they are. So you can't go to the hospital with your loved one. You can't be in the room with them. You can't sit there like we used to be able to do. So these days, comforting someone who is in a stressful situation like that is very difficult. I was so determined that he was gonna be fine, and to convince you that he was gonna be fine, that when you called to tell me that he was going to be fine, then I just totally lost my emotions, which was odd for me because I don't normally do that. That was pretty scary. It literally, it felt like that time just stopped. What do I do? What do I do? What do I do? And I just wanted to just get in the car and come back home right away. When I hung up the phone, I remember thinking, oh, I'm gonna get in the car and head home real quick, because I can comfort Tracy better if I'm there. But with COVID, we couldn't go to the hospital, and there was nothing else that Tracy could even do. So that makes it even more difficult these days to comfort people when such tragic things like this happen. What I would say to Jeffrey is, I'm so happy that you're okay. I'm so happy that you survived all of this. I'm so grateful that you're still here with us. And take care of yourself, please.
If you need anything, just let me know, and I'll be glad to bring it to you.
What actually occurred is I had a heart failure. That means that organ in your body ceases to function. Similar to kidney failure, liver failure, all of those can lead to dire consequences over time. But when you have heart failure, you stop then and there. I can't lift more than 5 pounds. Depending upon how thick the china is, some pieces of dinnerware, I can't lift more than one plate at a time, because 2 plates are more than 5 pounds. I can't lift a gallon of milk, because that's actually 8 point some pounds. I can't even pick up my laptop computer, because it weighs 6.2 pounds. I have to have someone pick up my computer, put it on my lap, or put it on the table wherever I'm going to be working, and then use it. And that's frustrating for me, because I'm a computer programmer. I want to be able to do things, and I can't. I'm restricted on water, my salt intake, canned vegetables, because of the amount of salt. I now have to go have frozen vegetables. My whole diet has shifted from what it used to be. Peanut butter and jelly sandwiches every day, not going to happen anymore. I can't have caffeine. I'm on decaf right now. Alcohol is a limited amount. Some things are forever, some things are not. Smoking, forever, can't smoke anymore. The caffeine, that depends on how well my body reacts to the change in the diet. I may or may not be able to add caffeine back into my diet. I love my coffee. I hate decaffeinated coffee, but I enjoy drinking it if I get the right type. It tastes okay, but salt, not a big worry about that. I have to be careful about the types of grains I eat. They have a whole list of things that I can and can't do from my discharge instructions. No sports that use my shoulder. I'm not allowed to drive a vehicle until I get okay by the doctor, which is going to be interesting because I go to work next week.
Hello.
I have to keep my arms down as much as possible. Do not put them out to the side behind me or over my head. Do not let anyone pull my arms to help me move or dress. Do not reach for items. Do not push or pull anything, including car doors, vacuum cleaners. I have to be careful about the wounds and how long I'm going to be on this. They don't know. There are certain types that I'll be on for 6 weeks, 6 months, or up to a year. Some of them may be 3 years. I'll be on baby aspirin for the rest of my life, like I have been taking, but the blood thinner's dosage may decrease after the stent is set and they know what's going on and there aren't any additional heart issues that they're dealing with, such as high cholesterol that could increase plaque buildup and everything else. Limit or don't drink alcohol as directed. Eat heart-healthy food. Low in salt, fat, cholesterol, includes fruits, vegetables, whole grain breads, low-fat dairy products, cheese. That's it. I can't eat cheese anymore. No more cheese. And if people who know me are out there watching this, you know I love cheese. I love cheese on everything. I love cheese on top of cheese. I'll eat cheese on cheese. I'll put Parmesan on top of the cheddar just because I'm having mac and cheese, just to include that. So I can't have any more cheese. Beans, lean meats, and fish. Maintain a healthy weight. So I'm going to have to lose about 20 pounds or more. I'm supposed to have a follow-up 2 to 4 weeks after I was discharged from the hospital. There'll be additional cardiac rehab that I'm going to have to do, which can be anywhere from 6 weeks to 6 months, different types of exercises. Right now, what's going on is the changes in my daily routine is I now have to, when I wake up, since I'm going to bed and falling asleep earlier, I wake up before my alarm clock, getting up between 5:30 and 6 every morning. And once I wake up, I have to go to the restroom and then I have to weigh myself. They want you to weigh yourself at the normally the same time after the same procedures every morning so they can get an accurate weighing process. There is also an area on the document that they provided for me, which is a calendar. I have to identify how the previous day was. I have what's called a green zone, a yellow zone, and a red zone. And you'll be able to follow along on the video with me. In the green zone, it says that everything is all clear. I have no shortness of breath, no weight gain of more than 2 pounds in one day, swelling in the feet, ankles, legs, or abdomen. I'm not having any chest pains, and there's no other significant symptoms. That's a green day, and you'll mark it on the little green box that's on the form. The yellow zone, which is a caution, they recommend to call your doctor, and that's if you have 3 pounds weight gain in one day or 5 pound weight gain in a week. More shortness of breath. You need to sleep upright in a chair in order to breathe. You have more swelling in your feet, ankles, legs, or abdomen. A dry hacking cough. I'm feeling more tired than usual. Dizziness, feeling of uneasiness. You know, something just isn't right. And then I'll have the red zone, which is an emergency, and it says to seek help now, call 911. And that's if I'm struggling to breathe, unrelieved shortness of breath while sitting still, I'm experiencing chest pain and confusion or can't think clearly. Those are the three areas that I have to identify how the previous day was each time that I weigh myself in the morning. So I mark the calendar with that. From what I understand is I do get tired easier, but I think that's from what I've been told through the nursing staff that I will be getting tired for the next couple of weeks a lot easier because my heart is trying to heal from what it had to go through. That will include sometimes shortness of breath, but it's not continuous. If I sit down and relax, the shortness of breath goes away. If I have any tinge or feeling of pain in my heart, that also would subside with resting, either laying down or sitting down based on what I'm doing, and that'll go away. All of those signs initially will occur because my heart's healing. As I get stronger, they should subside and no longer occur. These listings that they're showing that I'm reading here are issues that will occur after I'm healed, or even while I'm healing, but they'll be more prevalent, more pronounced, that I'll need to do something. After I get dressed, I then will eat my breakfast, make coffee, or have a glass of water, but eat something. And normally what I was doing before this occurred, I'd have toast with peanut butter, slab nice and thick on some toast with a big glass of milk. Not anymore. I get a bowl of Cheerios with a cup of milk, and I'll slice in some bananas or strawberries. I may do what my daughter does, Francis, and have some, get some blackberries or raspberries and throw those in there. I may even get some cherries and slice them, prepare them to put them in there. But that's a way to get the fresh fruit that I need to have in my diet. Also, Cheerios is actually excellent for high cholesterol, in reducing your cholesterol level. Since I'm drinking 2% milk right now, that again reduces low fat intake on my dairy products. Since it's only a cup, that still gives me a little over 1 3/4 amounts of fluid to have for the rest of the day. So again, I have to monitor how much fluid I have. Right now, instead of going to work, I get to come to my chair and I get to watch TV shows. I get to relax. I normally will take Tanner out in the backyard and toss the ball around with her. It gets me outside, gets her outside. She gets to run around and have fun. Lately, starting to get my exercise routine, I've been taking her out the front in the morning to get my newspaper. I'll take her out on the leash, walk down the driveway, walk down the sidewalk, walk back down the driveway. And if I feel up to it, I'll do another walk to the sidewalk and back again and try to build up my stamina that way to get my heart exercising back the way it's supposed to be. Eventually, I'll be up walking at least 30 minutes a day, if not all at one time, at least in sections where it'll accumulate to 30 minutes a day. And moving on from there, it's changing everything. Within the 7 drugs that I've been taking, I get this nice little thing here. This is nitroglycerin. These are tablets that you put under your tongue. They say you take them sublingual, you put them under your tongue and let them dissolve. That way they are received into the bloodstream faster. And these are taken as needed.
We have 4 little bottles. I carry one, Jeffrey carries one. There's one at his bedside. And then there's one in the kitchen.
We spoke with Marissa, my doctor's nurse, for an hour, and she explained all the meds that I was on to my wife, and to her satisfaction, and to me, as I was listening, to help me understand better, but more so she could understand better, because she actually is my caregiver now. And that's where I have to step back and realize that I can't do everything for myself. I have to have assistance, and I have to accept that, which I am beginning to learn to do, but it's still a little hard for me. But as long as she's aware of what I'm supposed to do, and I'm aware of what I'm supposed to do and what I'm not supposed to do, although I will fight back, I'll still do it because I know it's what's best and what's right. And it also gives me a little dig with her. So we get to banter back and forth about it. Besides, her best friend will call me and tell me that I need to pull my head out and do what's right. So that's going to happen. I got toilet paper. These are the issues that came when I got my meals. I took it home. These are great for pudding. I love these spoons for pudding. Drinking straw, toothbrush, and mouthwash, and toothpaste, real lemon juice, came with my tea on Friday night. Pill crusher, pill cutter. This is what they give you. Put on your feet. Sock slippers. One size fits all. And when I didn't have anything to eat for the first day I was there, they gave me tomato soup. Extra vomit bags they gave me. And this is my breathing process, so it's an exercise process. And I got a free box to put them in. Tracy gets to use this to soak her feet when she does her pedicures.
A pill container so that you don't have to count out the medication every day. We also have a water pitcher to track fluids. And so if he has a cup of coffee, then he would fill up a coffee cup of water and pour the water into the pitcher, and it measures out because you can only have 2 liters of fluid, and that's not what you're getting rid of. It's that the more fluid that's in your body, the harder the heart has to work. We have a shower stool, which is quite handy, and not that he would need it, but he likes to take really hot showers. And if he were to get lightheaded, because he's taking medications he's never taken before. So if he got lightheaded, he's got that stool right there. A handheld sprayer in the shower. We have a blood pressure machine now. It holds up to 99 readings for 2 different people. So it's quite fancy. We have this collapsible stool. It's 3.5 pounds. It has a shoulder strap. And if you need to take a rest, boom, you just open it up and sit down. Jeffrey probably doesn't need any of this, but I feel better just having it so that it would be easier on him if he needed to take a break. Maybe I might need to take a break, so I may use it. There have been some times that he'll go to sleep and I just watch him breathe. It scared me so badly. And I know faith and fear cannot be in the same space. So I have been praying and praying and praying. I have not slept more than 2 or 3 hours at a stretch since this happened. And I know I'm just trying to work through it. And I have just never been scared like that before.
I've never had pains like this before. Oh, this is the worst one I ever had, son. Oh, it's the worst one. This is a big one. I'm dying.
Oh, I want to thank everybody. Especially my wife for calling 911 when she did, instead of thinking that I was joking and saying, oh, I need to go see the doctor. No, I need to go to the hospital. And all of the technicians, I'm appreciative of all the EMTs that showed up, the 911 operator putting up with my smart remarks, the EMTs when they arrived, the docs, nurses, and then all the friends that prayed for me to make sure that I had a good recovery. Thank all them. I don't know what to say. I've never been a big talker. I've always spoken little. Lopsided cows, tornado cows, earth movers, test.
And hit it. No. And talk to Kathy. Like, pretend that's Kathy. Tell her about your day. About
hey, girlfriend.
There you go.
Well, if it's Kathy, she knows who I am. For those of you who aren't Kathy, my name's Jeffrey. Jeffrey. How you doing?
Okay, tell us. Like, we don't want 1-900 numbers calling back. That's attractive.
Sorry, I have to do my acting. I have to do my acting work.
Okay. Okay.
Good morning. Afternoon. Hello. My name's Jeffrey. She's Jeffrey.
This is our prom glass from May 1st, 1982, Mulvane High School.
Okay. So,
I'm going to
have to have a blooper thing at the end for sure. And action.
It's a beautiful day in the neighborhood. A beautiful day in the neighborhood.
Won't you be mine?
Could you be mine?
Now Tanner's in the glass.
That's fine, as long as she's outside.
I can cut her out of that.
I get my medications out of Walgreens.
It's gonna have to go on the other shoulder. That goes in the blooper reel. This should only take 30 seconds to do this. I love being married to you.
Well, this is being married to me.
Yeah, it is. Look, it holds a body and a dog.